never.
Do a sarcastic smile. Now do a real smile.
And welcome to episode 64 of Viva Physical Media. And we have a new website.
We do have a new website. Yes. I hope it's working.
I hope it's working so great. And I hope people are having so
We're
much filming fun
this
surfing
like
it.
2 weeks from when it actually turns on.
Yeah, but it'll be live. I mean, unless anything crazy happens when you guys see this. And it's scarecrowvideo.org. I'm pretty sure there'll probably be redirects to it if you go to the .gov.biz. it's angelfire.scarecrow.
Yes, exactly.
.tumblr.com.
Geocities.com/scarecrow.
My live journal, scarecrow. Scarecrowlivejournal.com. Anyways.
Jokerman font, completely.
No, it's all chiller. But it should be running pretty well, hopefully. You should be able to search for things and look around and...
Ideally, you'll be able to rent by mail really easy.
Yeah, it's like so easy.
Yeah.
And read all our the blogs and stuff, all the good stuff that was kind of hard because honestly, our old website...
WordPress not great.
Boo. Some other stuff happening. Zeitgeist.
The Unstreamables are doing a Zeitgeist.
September 30th.
That'll be like a Zoom discussion. They're going to talk about... certain unstreamable movies.
They're going to talk about some good ones. I didn't write down the ones they're talking about, but I was excited about. Oh, they're going to talk about Crossroads with Britney Spears.
They are going to talk about that one.
Which is unstreamable.
Yeah.
But just the way they talk about, just the way they bring to light all of the stuff that we have on our shelves that you can't track down on the World Wide Web of information.
It's not so super a highway sometimes.
Yeah. Sometimes it's like that stretch of freeway like between Tacoma and Olympia that they've been working on for 30 fucking years.
There's just
years.
Nothing there.
Yeah, but there's just cones there. And you're like, what the hell's going on?
Just cones.
Does anyone work here?
The cones
Hello?
Of shame.
In October, October's coming up. One of my favorite months.
Never heard
if
of it.
Not my favorite month. Scarecrow loves October because we love spooky movies. A lot of us do. We're doing the Psychotronic Challenge like we do
like
every year.
Yes.
Jensen always creates this awesome... list of horror movie prompts to try to get you guys to watch new and different things. So we'll be doing that hashtag SCV Psycho
Challenge,
I think.
You got it.
We'll talk about that more in future episodes. But tying in with that, the Egyptian, Sif Egyptian, is going to be showing some movies that we are presenting for Scarecrowber. Scarecrowber. Scarecrowber?
I don't know.
I don't know either. One will be hosted by us. We can't reveal the title yet because we have to get it locked in.
Yeah.
But Viva will be hosting a movie at the Egyptian.
It's going to be great if we can get the one we want.
Yeah. It's going to be awesome. So keep your eyes on our socials and this, and we'll announce that soon. Mm-hmm. We got magnets and stickers.
We do have magnets and stickers.
So yeah, we got some really cool magnets by Eli Wolf.
Good job, Eli. Thank you.
And we got Megan's, of course.
Great.
Amazing. And do we have any new sections around?
Lizzie Borden got added to the director section.
Lizzie Borden got added.
We just added the romance section upstairs in the drama room.
If you go back, I believe I talked about Working Girls on the show.
Mm-hmm.
Episode one.
Was it episode one?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Well, we got the hip hop section. I don't know if we talked about that last time.
We didn't. It wasn't up yet.
Okay. 50 Years of Hip Hop is this month, August. This will be September when this comes out, but I'm pretty sure this section will stay up. So come in, check it out. You may have also noticed we have a new segment that is just coming out. We're doing a rewind segment where Rich has edited little clips, different highlights from past episodes to kind of just put up in the meantime. So that's a fun trip down memory lane. Maybe help you discover some movies that you missed out on. And I think that's all the housekeeping stuff.
That was good. That was really well done.
Thank you. I took a lot of notes and then smeared them all with my wet hands.
It. You used to be such big, strong hands.
Thank you. Episode 64.
In the bag.
Yeah, we're done.
Out.
The Ben Special.
Hello, and welcome to the Ben Special, a segment where I highlight special features and DVD extras that I find to be especially extra. Today, I'm going to be talking about the 2006 film, Final Destination 3. If you haven't seen the Final Destination films, they are about a person who has a premonition of an impending disaster. This is usually a plane crash or a traffic pileup or a suspension bridge collapse. The premonition is shown in gruesome detail before backtracking right before the moment of the disaster. person that has the premonition freaks out and tries to warn everyone. They only ever manage to rescue a small group of people who get to safety before the disaster happens.
We have to get off of here. No, don't push the button! Don't push the button!
But Death is pretty pissed off about this, and Death is this invisible force that goes all slasher and picks off the survivors one by one in these grisly Rube Goldberg inspired freak accidents, being decapitated by a train, being decapitated by an elevator, being crushed by a sheet of glass, being obliterated by a barbed wire fence, being obliterated by a NASCAR tire.
Have you all lost your fucking mind?
Death is going hog wild on these people. I really think this is a fun series, apart from number four. And it's my favorite horror movie franchise, apart from number four. I think it's totally worth checking out. Apart from number four. I really can't stress that enough. Part four is just really awful. But Final Destination 3 is great. It centers around a bunch of high schoolers that are about to graduate. And they narrowly escape a roller coaster disaster, which is pretty intense. But when they were making the movie, the director and the DVD team were collaborating together. So they were filming the movie with the DVD interactive features in mind. So they filmed several scenes, several different times with a lot of different outcomes. So when you watch the movie, you can either watch the theatrical version or you can watch a choose their fate version.
Would you save innocent strangers from their final destination?
Which is basically a choose your own adventure in DVD form, where you, the viewer, get to attempt to save the poor souls that Death is trying to kill with these elaborate mousetrap style fatalities. The way it works is the movie goes on as normal, but certain scenes, things go into slow motion and a screen pops up with a decision that you have to make. And these decisions are, you know, heads or tails on a coin flip, or if you should turn the thermostat from 73 to 76 degrees, or if a character has a nail gun and is going to shoot a pigeon, should it be a kill shot or a warning shot? Just real, like, everyday decisions that one would have to make.
Okay, check around, babies, but you can't hide.
Going with the roller coaster disaster theme, each choice selection screen that pops up is sort of an old-timey carnival game, which looks pretty cool. You choose which one you would like. You basically just use your DVD remote, and then you just see what happens next. But you gotta be quick.
But fate is an impatient mistress, dear friend, and if a decision is not made quickly, she will choose for you.
I watched this, and I really tried hard to save as many people as I possibly could, but I'm very sad to report I was only able to save one person, and it was the one person I really, really didn't want to save, and that was Frankie Cheeks.
Frankie Cheeks is old school, ladies. What's that? Oh, well, it'd be my honor.
Ew.
And, oh, God, Frankie Cheeks is, like, maybe one of the most repulsive characters of the Final Destination universe.
Guess who's back?
And then if you save him later in the movie, there's an added scene where he's arrested for sexually assaulting an undercover police officer.
Oh, if we just crossed the street over to my stepmom's house and I filmed you, I would be able to pay you, like, be able to give you, like, $80.
$80?
Yeah.
big guy like you's gotta have some more cash than that. That wouldn't pay for my bikini.
110.
110?
Done.
Promise?
Yeah.
Oh, phew, because the girls are really gonna wanna see. I'm a police officer.
Fucking hell, Frankie. You cheated death not once, but twice. And this is what you're gonna do with the rest of your time on Earth. It's just like, what was the point of this? I prefer my Frankie Cheeks to have a car engine violently plowed into the back of his skull. Besides choosing character fates, you also have a few side options. One is towards the end of the movie, there's a newspaper that flutters around the New York subway, and you have the option to read the newspaper if you want to do so. I did that. And it's an article. It basically expands on the ending of Final Destination 2, where you get to find out the fate of some of the survivors from that movie. And I won't spoil it for you, but I will say that it involves an industrial wood chipper, and it is a huge bummer to read. The theatrical version of this movie is superior to the Choose Their Fate version. I think that if you're watching this movie for the first time, just watch the theatrical version, but then try the Choose Their Fate because it is a fun experience. And if you want to watch Final Destination 3, but you don't have time to sit for a whole feature-length film, the Choose Their Fate version offers a 20-minute cut of the movie where you can just be, you can watch the movie 20 minutes in, boom, done, and you're on with your day. It's saving you time. Also, as a word of warning, the Blu-ray for Final Destination 3, it does offer as a special feature the Choose Their Fate. This is not on this. It's a huge lie. I don't understand why they put it on here. I looked for it all on the disc when I had it, couldn't find it, thought maybe it was a hidden feature or an Easter egg. But I got on the internet and it was just a bunch of very angry people that felt duped. So don't be fooled. Check out the two disc, what do they call it? The two disc thrill ride edition. That's what you want. In conclusion, if you not only want to watch a movie, but you want to decide if characters get to live or die, or in this case, die or like really, really, really die, then the Choose Their Fate is a special feature for you. But please, if you watch this, just don't let Frankie Cheeks live. Just let him get the car engine in the back of the head. It's better for everyone involved. Frankie Cheeks, boo.
The first movie I'm gonna talk about is SUZHOU RIVER. By Liu Ye, directed in 2000. I haven't seen any of this guy's other movies. Are you familiar or just with this one?
I have seen three of his films.
He's a sixth generation director, of the Chinese directors that focus a lot on kind of the present day, like urban, not so prettiness of the city and kind of eschewing tradition. And this guy especially had a lot of trouble with censorship. And I think his first movie was banned for a long time. And then this movie was banned. And then he was banned from making films after this for a while. It's a movie, it's a character drama basically, uh-huh, about four people who are kind of interconnected. A lot of people compare this to Wong Kar-wai. You can see that definitely. It's a little different stylistically, I guess. But you can see like the editing style, some of the editing style and some of the aesthetics are kind of similar, and just how it's focused on a working class neighborhood. We start out with a narration by a videographer who is talking about him starting to date this woman he met at a tavern.
这个老板海阔天空跟我聊了半天，我才明白是要我替他的特色酒吧拍几个美人鱼的镜头。
And her job is to dress up as a mermaid and like be like the entertainment for the bar.
Did you know there's no mermaid bars in Seattle? where you can see like a mermaid act, like, you know, they're swimming behind the bar?
I mean, I'm not surprised because I feel like I would have heard about it.
That's what I'm saying. I'm just mad. I was looking for one and I couldn't find one.
Were you the one I was talking to you about watching that mermaid documentary?
That was why I thought about it.
Yeah.
Anyway, sorry.
That's okay. It is cool though. I wish there was.
Yeah, it'd be great.
She worked at one of those bars as one of the mermaids and he falls in love with her and he's kind of telling his love story.
更让我不明白的是，有时候美美会突然失踪一些日子，一连好几天没有任何的消息。
About how they got together and she would always like leave for days at a time.
好像什么事情都没发生过一样。
Eventually he was like, you know, when you leave, like, I miss you. And she's like, why don't you go search for me like this one guy did for this one girl? And it's this story about this guy, and I didn't write down their names, so I'm gonna have to keep being like this guy and this girl. But this guy was a motorbike courier for this vodka salesman, was like, but he also had like ties in with the mob or whatever. And he would take his daughter on the motorbike.
离婚之后只喜欢两样东西，酒和女人。每次约来一个女友，他就会打电话招来马达。
And during those times, he would fall in love with the daughter.
几次下来，马达和牡丹也就熟了，而且很对眼。
She was older. She wasn't like a kid or anything. But they started falling in love, and then there was this whole kidnapping scheme where he decided to hold the daughter for ransom, even though they were falling in love.
你让我爸出多少钱换我？你说什么？你让我爸出多少钱换我？45万。
And then she found out and killed herself by throwing herself into the river, said she would come back as a mermaid. So this guy in the story, this is a very fragmented non-linear narrative, which is kind of the charm of it as well. But this guy in the story also goes to the bar and sees the mermaid and thinks it is his long lost lover. And so there's all this different levels of storytelling where he kind of confronts her and tells her this story of his love life, his romance story. And she's like, oh, that's not me. It is played by the same actress. So we're not even sure if it is or if it isn't. And I'm not going to tell you more than that. But it's a really cool movie in that it layers all these different storytelling elements, all these different fragmented narratives. And visually, it's really awesome because it's just like this gritty, urban, not super pastoral, beautiful setting. And yet we see these like little moments of like romance between all these characters. I love any movie that deals with like similar identities between women that are like twisted, kind of like De Palma or Hitchcock-esque, you know?
我是你要找的牡丹吗？
Just this urban melancholy that it has is really, really effective. I really like this movie. It caused him to get a 2-year ban in filmmaking in China, which is worth it though. And then he kept making movies after that. He would send his movies to film festivals without the Chinese government's approval and shit. Real badass dude. Yeah. I wanna watch other...
I recommend, I've liked everything of his that I've seen, yeah.
Cool, well this is my first one.
A good friend of mine swears by this director.
Yeah, no. Totally. This is a good one. So, SUZHOU RIVER by Liu Ye. Check it out.
Here. Will you move that beer?
Yeah, I guess so.
My first movie is something that, man, you can't really see anywhere. You can find parts of it on the YouTube, but in the 80s, Don Johnson, Miami Vice's Don Johnson, solid, recorded an album, a rock album, called Heartbeat, and it's really bad. But what you didn't maybe know is that they also made a 65-minute film/music video for the entire record. Don Johnson's Heartbeat. This motherfucker will kill you.
Is it a movie?
Yes.
Or is it a very long music video?
Absolutely a movie and a very long music video. In it, Don Johnson plays a war photographer and documentarian who is in Latin America documenting some CIA-backed fucking uprising against leftists. When he is blown up in a rocket attack and then experiences a near-death experience where his entire life flashes before his eyes while he is in a 2001-esque room, like hospital room, where he like witnesses his entire life going before him
again.
What
if it was the lobby from that movie where Gary Busey turned into a dog?
It looks only slightly better than that. No, that's not true. It actually does look pretty good. This was very expensive, and it was directed by John Nicolella, who had done a few Vices at the time.
Cool. I mean, the tape itself looks badass as
fuck. It's amazing. And so, like, there's almost no dialogue in the movie. It's just a series of sort of vignettes.
And it's never moved off the tape.
No, never moved off the tape. He, like, remembers, you know, his time in Latin America. He remembers meeting a guy who was at first a rival, but then became a friend. He had some battles with some local drug dealers. His wife and him have since become estranged. You can pack your bags, take a walk. And all this stuff. In the middle of the movie, there is an unrelated duet with Willie Nelson. Isn't it amazing what the girl can do? Acting like she's happy when she feels so blue inside. There is a relatively explicit sex scene towards the end of the movie. This is one of the only music videos I've ever seen that has fucking in it. Like actual, you know, a sex scene. I also would like to read to you the cast of this film. Don Johnson, Paul Schaefer, David Letterman's bandleader, Giancarlo Esposito, Louis Guzman, Laurie Singer from your favorite show, VR5. Who else? Who am I forgetting? And I also am having trouble reading some of this stuff. That's right. Tubb shows up for like a sec. It definitely has like this Miami Vice cool swagger vibe.
Hell yeah.
Don Johnson does some of his most soulful sing acting in this. He's doing the thing. I'm sure you've seen this at bad karaoke where somebody's like really banging their heart out of karaoke and they're like, they're singing like this.
Yeah.
But he can't sing. So it's really just, it's cringy. No, you can't take that part of you. There isn't like a lot to this. It's more like a full experience. Like there's it's kind of like the Matrix. Like no one can tell
like
you what it is.
Something I did not know. You gotta find ever out for existed. Yourself.
And like I said, it's only 65 minutes, so this is not gonna take you up a lot of time. Now you can watch pieces of this on YouTube, but it's just the musical numbers, so they cut out all the like connective tissue that's actually telling the story. But don't mistake me, this is a movie as well as a music video. Like, it does tell a story about how this guy, like, realizes that he wants to live.
This is crazy. I bet no one knows about
this. As his life flashes before his eyes. I mean, some people know about it, but I'm hoping to keep this, like, out into the public eye. Because I first encountered this thing, like, 15 years ago, just, like, putting movies away here.
Yeah.
And I was like, what the fuck is this? Took it home, and the guys will tell you, like, I came back, and I was like, you have got to see this.
Heartbeats
thing.
Changed, and that's life.
I promise you, I'm not overselling it.
I kind of believe you. It looks like one of those weird oddities that, like, is a surprising gem.
There's nothing else out there like it. I've seen so many vanity projects in my day, but there's nothing quite like this because It's not like, say, Beverly Hills Cop 2, where, like, Eddie Murphy's now the biggest star in the world and he's just doing whatever he wants and the whole thing's fucking lazy. Like, somebody really tried, and also Don Johnson thinks he is that cool.
Yeah.
So it's unmistakable, unmissable, unstreamable. You have to see it. Don Johnson, Heartbeat.
Hey, it's me. I'm not Matt. I'm Kevin.
Hey.
I'm here. Oh, cut that part.
What are you doing?
I'm sitting here hanging out.
Yeah?
I've been wanting to talk about a few movies for a while now, but due to traveling and other situations, I hadn't been able to. So now I'm here hanging out. I just showed up. Now I'm going to chat about some movies.
Good. I'm excited. Okay? Yes, please.
All right, cool.
What do you got?
My first movie is a cult classic, but I feel like maybe... I don't know. It feels like people aren't talking about it a lot anymore, and I watch it about once a year, once every other year, and I love it, which is Battle Royale.
So good.
I was talking to the Ben Special about it, and he said a thing that I think, like, a lot of people, because he said he watched it, like, got, like, burned out on it, like, years ago. It was, like... such a fucking cult hit. I remember when I first started working here, it was one of the biggest movies here. And it was never shown in theaters in the US.
Didn't it have like an import disc at first or something?
Yeah,
Nick was saying that the first movie he rented from here was Battle Royale, like an import disc of Battle Royale. Yeah. He like tried to play and he's like, oh, fuck.
Years ago, when we went through Brain, the old POS system, mm-hmm. and found out what the most popular movies ever rented here were, and Battle Royale was number one at the time.
Yeah, it was huge here though, but it's still like a cult classic, you know?
Yeah,
like,
for sure. Because
it was never shown in theaters in the U.S. except for, as far as I know, festivals, including SIFF, where Rich saw it at the fucking Cinerama. You can all ask Rich his story about seeing Battle Royale in the theater like the rest of us never got to do.
I don't know how I stumbled upon it when I first saw it. I think I might have like torrented it or something.
Yeah.
Because I like saw film stills from it or something like that.
Yeah, the first time I saw it was before I moved to Seattle and it was like a, you know, a rip from the internet way back in the day that like a friend of mine had or something, you know. Because that was the only way you could really see it here. Mm-hmm. You know, besides these import discs that we had. Anyway, for those of you who don't know what Battle Royale is, it takes place in the near future in, like, a sort of dystopian Japan or whatever, but they...
It ran so Hunger Games could walk.
Yeah, basically, yeah. Basically, Hunger Games ripped it off.
いいか?この国は、この国の分みたいなやつのおかげで、すっかりダメになってしまいました。だから、
Every year in Japan, they take, because kids are so bad and crime is so bad, and they take a class of kids. They say like middle school, but it feels like these kids are in high school. And so they take these kids, put them on an island. They give them these rules that are all delivered by this adorable Japanese girl who's smiling the whole time while she tells these kids they're going to have to go out and kill each other. So they have to go out on this island and murder each other. And before you say, well, can't they just swim away or whatever? They can't because they all have strapped around their neck as these collars. And if they disobey or get outside of out of bounds or whatever, their necks explode. And there's an amazing scene at the beginning that explains all of it. I think this is just it's an incredible movie. Directed by Kinji Fukasaku, is his final film. He's done a ton of great movies, but watching this again, I'm like, this is, I think, his magnum opus. It is just, it's incredible how much storytelling is done in a little bit of time. And the director's cut has like some extra scenes. If you cut those out, it's still fine. It's kind of like the most awesome high school TV show, almost condensed. There's so many characters in this movie, but each one of them, before they get, you know, killed or kill somebody or whatever, has a little scene. You meet a character, Chucky Kariyama's character, who played Gogo Yubari in Kill Bill.
Hi.
She's in the movie for maybe 5 minutes, but then, spoiler alert, I guess, when she's dying, it's like a tragedy. And you've known this character for this long. And the movie's full of stuff like that, plus an amazing performance by Beat Takeshi, who's just awesome as like the sadistic teacher who kind of has a personal vendetta against this specific class. But also has a weird crush on the main girl too. But also paints this amazing painting, and I've looked for prints of it. I've looked for prints of it everywhere, and you can't find one. There's people that have like sort of recreated it, sort of, and it's not the same. It's not as good.
Damn.
So if anybody knows where I can get a print of Takeshi's fucking painting of all the kids dying on the island from the end of this movie,
dude, that would be
please let me know.
Oh man,
I think this is an awesome movie. I think it's. I don't know if it's still relevant to
dude,
whatever, but...
It's so good. It was one of the first movies. It was, like, in the realm of time when I started getting into, like, what I thought at the time were, like, weirder, like, edgier movies. You know what I mean? It was definitely one of those gateways for me.
Yeah, and it totally fulfills, like, on all of the promise of, like, a bunch of kids murdering each other on an island where it's like, oh, it's just the part, it's just gonna be these kids killing each other. Isn't that gonna be like wild and cool? It is until like you kind of like some of them or you like understand where they're coming from.
And
you go like, oh, well. Oh, I don't want to see these. There's this whole sequence with these girls who are all like best friends in this lighthouse.
Oh,
and it's
yeah.
just amazing.
I always think about that when I think of this movie.
It's so good. It's like, man, this would be like 10 episodes of like a TV show or something, but it's all taking place in like 5 minutes. And it's so, and super fucking bloody and stuff, too. Battle Royale, I love it. It was one that I popped on again recently and was like, I gotta talk about this one.
I feel like
Viva.
It's like endlessly rewatchable too.
And I don't know that people are like talking about it as much anymore since it got its like Blu-ray release here, but man, if you haven't seen Battle Royale, check it out. If you haven't seen it in a while and you liked it at the time, I suggest watching again because it's constantly rewarding every time I watch it.
I'm going to be talking about this TV show miniseries called The Kingdom by Lars von Trier.
Ooh, I've never seen this.
This has been something I've wanted to watch for a long time, but I just hadn't really gotten to it. And then I was like, you know what? Fuck it. I'm going to watch it. Lars von Trier put out a third season last year.
On Mubi. Yeah.
Which I haven't seen because, I mean, I just finished this like 2 nights ago.
Sure.
I've been watching, this has been my bedtime show for the past couple of weeks. And I've really liked the ride. Let me tell you a little about this place called The Kingdom, Kevin.
I can't wait.
This is written and directed by Lars von Trier. The first season was also co-directed by someone named Martin Arnfred. And it was co-written, both seasons were co-written by Niels Vorsel. I don't know how to say these people's names. Also, all the characters' names I'm not even trying. Trier, basically, he wanted to get a bunch of money and he thought TV would be a good idea. They offered him money to make a TV series and he was very inspired by Twin Peaks. Like, you'll see people all the time comparing this to Twin Peaks, but he was directly inspired by it. So basically, the movie's called The Kingdom, which is the nickname for the hospital. It's a real hospital they filmed on location at.
Welcome to Rigshospitalet. Rigshospitalet is a hospital for patients who need highly specialized treatment. With more than 8,000 employees and at any one time 3,000 inpatients, we are in effect a small town.
And it's actually still I think it's like the city's biggest hospital today.
Okay.
At the beginning of each episode, they kind of talk about how this hospital was built on these kind of swampy bleaching ponds where people in the olden days would bleach their textiles, and it was like all gross and swampy and kind of mysterious and shit. Okay. And the foundation is crumbling and like there's evil lurking. So things are going weird in this hospital. And then it cuts to the intro to each of these episodes. Basically looks like if you ever watch Trauma ER or any of those live ER shows from like the 90s where it's like quick cut, like dun, 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 and it shows like the ambulance and stuff. It's like that, and then it intros the characters. And this show is basically just a hospital drama comedy with like some weird supernatural elements. It's like Twin Peaks meets X-Files meets ER, which I know you're a big fan of.
I'm a huge fan, yeah.
So we're introduced to a bunch of different characters, and we are witness to all their like interpersonal drama as well as these weird supernatural things happening. The first season is very much moved along by this old woman. Her son works at the hospital.
Oh.
He's kind of like a, I don't really know what he does. He's not like a nurse or a doctor. He might be like some sort of like facility manager or something like that. He's kind of dumb, but she just hangs around there and everyone's like, you're not a patient, you need to go home. And she's like, no. She's all of a sudden hearing the ghostly cries of a girl in an elevator. She's like, you know what? I'm gonna like Miss Marple this shit. I need to figure out what's going on in this hospital. So she's kind of our main entryway into the kingdom and its ghostly happenings. Our other main character is this guy from Sweden.
Namne Helmer. Överläkare Helmer.
Who was newly transferred. He's a neurosurgeon and he hates all Danes. He hates Danish people.
Här, Danmark. Utskitet av kalk och vatten. Och där, Sverige. Hugget. I granit. Dansk. Jävlar. Dansk! Jävlar!
And he's in there and he's like, I hate being at this hospital. Everyone's stupid. Like, I'm the best. And he's also trying to cover up this malpractice thing. And there's like one piece of paper that proves that he did it. And one of the subplots is he has to like make sure that paper doesn't get in the wrong hands. We have a nurse who's pregnant with a rapidly growing fetus inside of her. She eventually gives birth to Udo Kier.
Of course.
He becomes this big, growing, gross monster, but he's really just a baby.
Wow.
It's really disgusting and creepy and unsettling. Udo Kier also plays a ghost doctor. They do a bunch of ambulance drag races where they're making bets on who can drive the ambulance the fastest, but there's also a ghost ambulance. Throughout all this, there's two young people who work down in the dishwashing basement. Time and time again, we cut back to them saying foreboding, very kind of riddle-esque things about what's happening in the hospital. It's very creepy.
The lille pige har givet sig til kende for den gamle dame.
There's a guy who drinks poison and becomes a zombie. It's all over the place. It's very, very silly. It's sillier than I thought it would be. I thought it was gonna be really kind of creepy. It's very, very silly with very disturbing and unsettling creepy aspects around it.
All right.
Also with a big focus on kind of the banality of evil and how evil is in the selfishness of people and their relationships with one another. It was filmed on 16mm with some sort of really gross, like pea yellow filter. So it looks absolutely terrible, but that's almost part of what makes it what it is, I guess. At the end of every episode, the end credits roll, Lars von Trier himself comes out wearing a suit against this red velvet curtain and he goes, thanks for watching this episode. And then he talks in very like, metaphorical flowery language about the episode.
For der er åbenbart et eller andet, der er helt galt i disse bygninger. Og så er der en fremmed, der kalder. Hvor ofte er det ikke sket for dem selv, at nogen kaldte? Og hvor ofte var de så rede til at række hånden frem? Var det tit? Eller sjældent? Eller måske aldrig?
And then he ends doing the devil horns, which is very cool.
What a dork.
I know. He ends being like, I'm Lars von Trier. I hope you have a very good evening. I ended up really loving this, and it does end on quite the cliffhanger. Okay. I'm not going to spoil, but the main two people, the Swedish neurosurgeon that transferred in and then the kind of Miss Marple-y older lady, both passed away before they can film season 3. So it was kind of just forever pushed off until last year when Lars von Trier got a bunch of the same actors from the two previous seasons to come together for season 3. So I'm excited to track that down and watch it.
You're right.
And see how it settles up all the happenings at the kingdom.
Well, I'm gonna watch the first episode of this tonight.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I liked the second season a lot more because it does get a little bit creepier. Plus it has the Udo Kier baby demon guy. But I'm really happy I dove into this because it's definitely unlike anything I've seen. And it was a good nighttime watch for me the past couple of weeks. So if you haven't seen The Kingdom, check out The Kingdom.
I was going to talk about a movie this week.
Were you?
But then it turned out that you were going to talk about it too.
Yeah, well, I watched this movie about almost 2 months ago with the intention of talking about it. And then, like, because for whatever reasons, I wasn't able to get on the show. And then you texted me and said, hey, have you done this on Viva? And I said, no, but I was planning on it. And so anyway, we've never done this before.
So Kevin and I are both going to talk about this movie that we both really like a lot, I think.
Yeah.
And it's Roman Coppola's 2002 movie.
2002, yeah.
CQ. Roman, son of Francis, mm-hmm. brother of Sophia, who makes a cameo appearance in this movie.
She does, yeah. You might remember when I talked about Bram Stoker's Dracula on here at some point, and he did all the special effects.
Which comes up here.
Coppola fired the special effects people that were saying, we can't possibly do what you want us to do. He's like, I'll fire you then. My son will do it. And he did. It's amazing.
I really liked this when it came out. I was very excited for it when it came out in 2002. Went to see it, really enjoyed it. Bought the DVD, owned that for many years. Watched this a few times, but I hadn't seen it in a really long time.
Yeah, I hadn't seen it forever.
And now that I'm 20 years later, I'm in my mid-40s. This movie hit me in a totally different way.
I thought at the time we were like probably the same age as the Jeremy Davies character in it. So part of me is like, I don't know about this guy.
Yeah, and also like I was less interested in the day-to-day stuff in his life and more interested in the cool movie he's making seems neat. I want to watch that.
Yeah. Which it is.
It is, yeah.
You mean Project Dragonfly.
Operation Dragonfly.
Oh, sorry.
This takes place in the 60s in France, in Paris.
Right.
And Jeremy Davies is a sound guy, and he's working on this grungy Italian exploitation spy movie called Operazione Dragonfly.
Soon be ready to leave our lunar domes to descend and bring change to Earth.
Directed by a grumpy director played by Gerard Depardieu.
Who's great.
Who's really hilarious in this.
It ends with a beginning. Yes, a circle.
And produced by a guy played by Giancarlo Giannini, who is absolutely supposed to be Dino De Laurentiis.
Yeah.
Is that your idea of an ending?
Yeah. You don't have an ending! We make an action movie with no action. It doesn't make any sense.
Who punches a hole in the wall?
Bullshit!
That's Gerard Depardieu.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. They fire the director. He gets fired because he won't sort of acquiesce to Giancarlo Giannini's demand.
If you're thinking of changing one frame of my revolution...
You lost the picture! Each moment I spend with you, I'm losing money. Fabrizio, shut down this production.
What did you say? What did you
lost? Because he thinks, oh, this is art, this is poetry, there's poetry to it. And it can't end this way. And their producer's going like, just end it this way. It doesn't fucking matter.
Well, and also, crucially, like, they're filming this during, like, the May 68 riots and, like, revolution stuff that's going on, the political unrest in Paris.
So that stuff's in the movie.
And the director is trying to work this revolutionary spirit into his film.
Right. It's still, and you know, then you see the footage and it's still corny as hell because it's Billy Zane wearing a beret on the moon.
You need to be free to make love all day.
every day. Must be afraid.
That's an important part of the movie because we'll talk about this a little later, but a big part of this movie is what enthusiasm and vigor and love that you have in your youth and how that may drain out of you as you get older and how you deal with that.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Jeremy Davies is also making his own movie, which is a documentary of his own life. It's clearly based on a very, very famous movie called David Holtzman's Diary.
Which is the original
mockumentary
original
basically.
Fake documentary.
Yeah.
She's a pretender. She, you know, the nails and she's slobbers and...
Oh, no, it's me, it's all me. She'll slip in the bed without a word, without even a hello, maybe a scowl, and I'm gonna stop her this time.
My favorite moment in the movie is when he's like, we see the clips of his film. We see him describing what it is to his French girlfriend, this flight attendant.
Yeah.
And he's like, I'm trying to make something true and honest and real. And she goes,
what if it's boring? Did you ever think about that?
And he ignores her for his work.
Yeah.
You know, he is preoccupied with his documentary. He's preoccupied with the promotions he's getting working on the spy movie.
He's preoccupied with the lead actress of Operation Dragonfly.
Angela Lindvall, who plays Flicka in Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Yeah.
Saying, I'm in love with you.
I'm in love with you.
I'm more than.
Shut down.
We see the movie that he's making, Operazione Dragonfly, which is a really, really fun Italian sci-fi spy movie, clearly ripping on Danger Diabolic.
And Barbarella.
And Barbarella, yeah. Like, there's very specific references to both movies throughout.
There's, like, a scene where she's undressing on her spaceship or whatever.
And she lives in a spaceship that's also her apartment at the top of the Eiffel Tower.
Yeah.
And she has, like, a robot assistant. There's a scene where she's, like, writhing around naked on the bed with a bunch of money, which is right out of Danger Diabolic.
Please, are you prepared to accept this mission?
Deep, deep dive.
I kind of wish they'd just made that whole movie, too. Not that it would be better than this or whatever, but more like, I just want to see that movie. I also want to see that movie. Yeah. It looks awesome.
There's a band called Mellow that did the score for this.
Which
that did
great.
A really great job.
Love and mystery.
It's like a good score for the sort of regular parts of the movie.
Yeah.
But then the score for Dragonfly is like a dead on score ripoff of Danger Diabolic, which, by the way, you can't get. Danger Diabolic's score is completely unfindable because the masters were lost many, many, many years ago. It's never been officially released.
Yeah, if you ever hear soundtrack clips from it, it's all ripped
from the movie. Yeah.
This is most unprofessional.
All that's sort of the description of the plot and sort of What's really interesting about this is just how the whole thing feels. When I was a kid, I wanted this to be more Dragonfly. I wanted it to be exciting. I thought it was so fun, and it talked about making the kind of movie that I wanted to make and I wanted to see. And now that I'm old, it's like I watch this now and all I see is the stuff about how, like, kind of what a shitty kid this guy is, and how, like, he's failing his relationships and how he is devoted to this thing that he doesn't believe in. There's a great scene where he meets his dad at the airport, which is the only time they really get to see each other at Christmas, and it's Dean Stockwell.
He's great.
Oh, it's good to see you. Just good to see you at Christmas, even though it's briefly. Wait a second. I brought you something.
Thanks, Dad.
And Dean Stockwell is like, when are you going to have kids? Kids are so nice. You know, I loved you. I was always faithful to your mother. You might have a brother somewhere. And, like, he has this really heartfelt, very honest, but sort of almost casual conversation with him in the airport. It's very sweet.
You really get a sense of why Jeremy Davies' character is like that in that conversation. You're like, oh, okay, I see why
he's like this.
Seems like it's pseudo-autobiographical because it's, Roman Coppola making this movie. It takes place in the 60s, about these filmmakers, and you have to, some of it has to be from his experience growing up with Francis Ford Coppola, right, as his dad.
That's kind of like when you watch like Darjeeling that he was also kind of involved in, and yeah, it's like, oh, that's Coppola and that's Jack Nicholson and that's Peter Bogdanovich.
Right,
and,
right. You know. There's also a great performance by Jason Schwartzman in this.
He's terrific. Now, do you think he's playing someone kind of specific, or do you think that's like a catch-all? Because he's got like some Bava going on there.
Yeah, yeah.
I think there's some other stuff.
I don't know. Well, because he's American.
He's American, yeah. Felix DeMarco.
But I mean, I just like it because it's there's supposed to be the contrast, because all the people making Operation Dragonfly, who they keep, you know, Jeremy Davies replaces the other director, Gerard Depardieu. Mm-hmm. But like,
Jason Schwartzman replaces him, and then he quits.
Right.
And then, yeah.
He gets in a car accident.
Yeah, he breaks his leg.
But like, there, he's like a counterpoint to them, because he's like making this stupid vampire movie, and he's going, yeah! Go, yes, do it, and he's
be
like
more
so
sexy.
He's so dumb,
yeah,
and it's just like but everybody likes him. All the other directors are like, but what about the art? What's this about? And it's like, man, I don't know. It's about a lady who lives on top of the Eiffel Tower in a spaceship. Yeah. Whatever. But Billy Zane is really fun in it too. I think this is a really great movie. I don't know, and I like it. I don't want to spoil the ending.
The ending's kind of the only part that I didn't go for.
Yeah, I mean, it works for me, though.
It works. Like, I understand. It makes sense. It's organic, but I wanted him to learn a little bit more than he did.
Yeah, you know. But, you
That's
know,
just me being old.
It's a really fun movie.
It's gorgeous.
It's weirdly hard to find. This DVD has a ton of great extras. There's 5 making-of documentaries, one by Sofia Coppola and one by Eleanor Coppola, mm-hmm, who's his mom, who did Hearts of Darkness. There's a concert by Mello on here, or at least, like, part of one, like, of them mm-hmm, live in Japan. Anyway, it's, like, one of those things that has a ton of, I mean, audio commentaries, all kinds of shit. It's so full of all kinds of extra features. It's nuts.
It's a weird little movie.
It's weird. It's weirdly like one that's just like fallen under the radar. And you talk to people, and a lot of people are like, oh yeah, I think I saw that, or I meant to see that, or oh yeah, but like nobody's. And then other people go, I have not heard of that.
I'm pretty sure I saw the trailer for this in front of the Royal Tenenbaums and was like, holy shit, that looks amazing. I can't wait for CQ.
Yeah, it was awesome. And I used to have this really cool CQ promo t-shirt that I got from work.
It had the Morse code on it?
It had like the silhouette of her and then the Morse code of CQ,
nice.
CQ. And then Paige.
Huh.
Paige Fukuhara, who used to work here. We all, well, friends of
ours. We all know Paige.
Matt knows Paige. Yeah. anyway, she always coveted that shirt. And now I can't remember if I just wore out and I got rid of it or if I eventually gave it to her. So, Paige, if you're watching this, let me know.
She did used to like this movie very much.
She was upset. Every time I'd wear that shirt, she'd be like, I want your shirt!
In that weird aggro way that she would say everything?
Yeah.
Yeah, CQ, great movie.
Check it out.
Oh, are you going back to set? I'll let you know if I get any other great ideas.
Buckle up, buttercups.
Because we're talking about
Doggone Love.
The hit from 2004 by Rob Lundsgaard.
The smash hit from 2004 that is completely unstreamable.
This guy has only ever directed this except for... He also directed... He was additional directing credit for the Mary-Kate and Ashley Olsen movie Winning London.
Oh, that's my favorite one.
Is it?
Never seen it.
It's not bad.
This is really hard to see. The DVD is like, you know, you can find them, but they're not a lot out there. It's totally unstreamable. There are places where I look to see it because I wasn't sure that the DVD that I had a copy of was going to play because it was all scratchy.
So we got this movie. Well, we already had this movie in our library, but
if you watched the last mailbag, our friend Sophia sent us an additional copy of this because she thought it looked like a fun movie for us to try.
And to be fair, if, you know, I understand being at a thrift store or something and being like, oh shit, look at this, A Doggone Love.
Those one of my Viva favorite, guys.
Yeah, the Viva guys love what, or they don't love, well, I don't know. No. They watch dog movies, and this seems like a weird one.
Mm-hmm.
It was a weird one.
Not in a good way.
No, it wasn't really a dog movie either. His dog's name is Lucky, very cute, scrappy little pup. Unfortunately for Lucky, we do not see a lot of him in this movie.
No.
And it's very misleading because as you see in the cover of this movie, which isn't even Lucky, this isn't Lucky.
That's the girl's dog.
I don't even remember her name. But you think this would be a dog movie. Dog on love, dog on a leash here. And then I believe it says sex lies in doggy bones.
I don't even know what that is. Yeah, unfortunately the dog part is really immaterial.
Inconsequential.
Yeah. It kind of turns in, like, the dog's important at the end, but the only a little bit.
But not even.
Not even.
It starts off strong, because you think it will be a dog movie, because it starts off with a dog fantasizing about licking another dog's face in, like, slow-mo, soft lighting. It's basically like a dog lovemaking dream.
Mm-hmm.
But in reality, the dog's just licking a human's toes.
It's amazing. My dog never licks my toes.
The main guy is a writer.
I am a brilliant writer.
He's a writer, and he's working on his next book.
There's nothing special about it.
Needs more zhuzh.
Needs an edge.
But it needs more flair.
What does that even mean, more flair?
Well, you are pretty run-of-the-mill.
She's not talking about me, she's talking about the book.
Oh, well, you write what you know.
Hey, appreciate that.
He has a terrible haircut.
Yeah, he's the guy,
a gambling addiction.
Hey, Nicky, I need a little more credit.
I'm sorry, kid, you're down 14 grand, you're in too deep.
No, I'm about to hit, I can feel it!
Steve, it's over.
He has a gambling problem, he's in hock to the bookies for a considerable sum. And that's why he needs this new book to be a success. But his publishers are like, we're not going to be able to get you a big advance for this.
Yeah, it's a snooze fest.
Another snoroboro. He decides that he's going to write a gay character into the book.
Because it was originally just a love story, but he's like, you know what would make it really stand out?
With the youths. Is if we queered it up some.
And he was inspired to do that because...
The vet is gay.
He sure was cute.
Yeah, I love scruffy dogs.
No, not the dog, the guy.
Too bad he's straight.
Uh-uh, that boy ain't straight.
Oh, Tristan, you think everyone is gay, or should I say you wish everyone was gay?
The vet is gay, and the vet assistant girl, who our main guy has a crush on, thinks that he is also gay.
Yes.
See?
Yeah, I guess you're right.
And so she kind of is like, let's start hanging out.
Nothing like them. All the other gay men I know are, I don't know, you're different. Well, I'll see you Saturday.
You're gay, right?
He also decides to work this into his book and, like, do it as research.
Yeah, so he's like, okay, yeah, I'm gay.
Uh-huh.
And he thinks he can get closer to her by pretending. Keep in mind, this is 2004.
Yeah.
So this is, like, the weird, like, all the rage of, like, making fun of the stereotypical gay man.
Here, show me how you drink. No. Too hetero. You gotta do that thing with your pinky. You know, I'm not doing that.
And all that really, like, homophobic stuff that comes with it.
Yeah.
This movie is
kind of under the guise of kind of pretending like it's funny and progressive and, like, real. There's a lot of yucky
things.
Gay humor in this stuff. Gay jokes, a lot of homophobia. It's not very pleasant.
A lot of sexism, too.
Who wants cheese on their burger?
I want 2 slices. Ready?
How many times do I need to tell you I am lactose intolerant?
Pussy.
They drop a lot of F-bombs.
Couple.
Fruitcake.
He's got an ex-girlfriend who dumps him because he's Jordan Ladd from Cabin Fever and Death Proof. And she's your books suck.
Whoa, sucks. What does that mean?
What part of sucks do you not understand?
She keeps showing up throughout the movie being a
psycho. And
being
like, you're not gay, or like, oh, you're gay now, or something. See, even us talking about it just sounds so stupid.
It sounds yucky.
And it's like, because it is.
Yeah.
And we're not, like, making this sound worse. This is just, like, how bad it is.
Yeah.
And the dog's around, yeah, but the dog is never part of this.
Not until the end when he, like...
Wait. I took some notes.
Okay.
There is one part where our main guy spills coffee on his lap and then accidentally clicks a link to gay porn. He's Googling a man named Gaylord.
Yeah.
And then there's a ad for gay porn, and then his employee sees him, like, scrubbing the coffee
off. And he's, like, thinks he's beating off and stuff.
Get on up and move your butt. There's things like that throughout this entire movie.
There's the part towards the end when the lie has been revealed.
Yeah.
And he's now trying to convince the lady he loves that he's not gay. And she comes to his house and sees the bookie who he owes all the money to. Sobbing in his lap and, like, begging for forgiveness.
and she thinks he's like blowing him. And then she sees him give the bookie the money that he owes him.
She's like, I saw you give money for a blowjob.
I saw you give this bookie $14,000 for head.
The main girl, actually, the main girl is, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the amazing movie Bring It On, but she's Big Red from Bring It On.
That's right.
And she's also in some other stuff. And our main dude, you said he's from
Spin City.
But he's all, you know what else he's in?
Mm-mm.
A probably similarly shitty movie called Cop Dog.
Maybe we should do that.
Eventually, probably we will.
That's ridiculous and gross.
Yeah, this movie, I truly hated it. It's very sexist, very homophobic, very problematic. Truly do not recommend. One little cute thing that I liked about this movie was how our main guy would leave voicemails for his dog when his dog was home
and his
alone.
Friends make fun of him for it.
Yeah, but he'd be like, hey, buddy, I'm going to be home soon. Hope you're doing good. I hope you ran around with the ball and stuff.
If but that's I had like an the answering machine, the most... I would call Lily and leave messages for her.
There's so many times where I'm like, oh, I should text Louise. And I'm like, wait, she's a fucking dog. What am I thinking?
She doesn't even have thumbs.
At the end, Lucky gets hit by a car.
Which... Lucky, no! No!
Which I was like, this is such bullshit. You don't give me this dog throughout this entire movie. But you keep him sweet and cute. He's also lonely because you're leaving him alone all the time. And he falls in love with the girl's dog.
All right, here we go. Come on, buddy. Come on. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. Good boy.
Yes.
And then they break up, so he's sad on top of that.
You think he tried to get hit by a car because
you think he tried to kill himself because the movie sucks so bad? Damn. I don't know, but he doesn't work. And he doesn't kill himself.
No, he makes
and
it.
And
he
goes to the vet. I don't even know why
and then
they did
that. Then they reconcile.
Yeah, then they reconcile.
That's it. At the end, they're together.
He's going to make it.
The end.
So, Sophia...
So it worked. So his plan to pretend to be gay totally worked.
And that's how you should... Guys, if you want to know, like, how to get close to a girl.
Yes. Lies and
honestly,
deception.
Honestly, it's like, this is the only way to do it, really. This is the only way to really, like, earn her trust and, like, be really attractive. Because we all know that, like, a homophobic liar is super hot.
That's gold.
If Soul Man taught us anything.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
So, I feel really bad that, Sophia, you thought you were... I do feel bad.
It's not Sophia's fault.
No, it's not her fault at all. That's why I feel bad.
Okay.
Because the intentions were pure. And if anyone out there sees like a weird looking dog movie at a thrift store, please like grab it and we will.
Maybe see if we have it first so you don't have to spend your own money.
Or like have someone vet it first.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think maybe Sophia needs to let Maverick do the vetting in the future. He has really good taste.
He has really good taste. How many paws?
I'm gonna give this like a half a paw. It was really bad.
It's very, very bad. If even a paw.
I have a strong stomach for this kind of thing, but I was kind of mildly offended by it, and it was ugly and boring.
Did you say something about music in here that surprised you? There's like a music drop, a needle drop, or something.
Oh yeah, there is a Candlebox needle drop at the end.
I don't know who Candlebox is, so it didn't
mean to treat you bad. That's all.
Yeah. This one's a stinker, but next one should hopefully be a little better.
We needed a real palate cleanser after this, so we're going for something tried and true.
We're going back to three of our good buddies.
Homeward Bound Dose. Lost in San Francisco.
They're running away from the trolley.
Oh, the trolley problem.
I'm really excited. I actually have never seen this one.
I don't know
if any of the voices are the same.
There's no way to find out.
I'm excited to see some like 90s San Francisco scenery, you know? I'm excited to see some dogs.
Directed by David R. Ellis, who you might know from such films as Final Destination.
What the fuck?
And I believe Snakes on a Plane?
What the hell? Michael J. Fox is made to voice Chance, so I'm really excited to be reunited with these dogs.
Robert Hayes is back too.
Nice.
And we know for a fact this will be about the animals.
And they're lost in San Francisco, so I'm sure there's fentanyl and like horrible socioeconomic iniquity in it.
Hang out with a bunch of hippies.
The rent is too fucking high.
Yeah. They're going to have to walk up hills and eat burritos.
They have to get Ubers. They have to get jobs driving Ubers.
And so forth.
Anyway, stay tuned for that. Nothing short of astounding, according to the Chicago Tribune.
I believe it.
Me too.
In the balloon business, it doesn't get any bigger than the Gaylord Monkey balloon account.
Well, that's so good. We did great.
Episode 64 was really good.
In the can.
In the can.
As they say.
As they in the do business. Say in the biz. A lot of good movies.
This business we call show.
Yep. So 64 in the can. That was awesome. Thank you guys for watching. We talked about some good movies. We talked about a bad movie. And
can't all be winners.
No, and that's why we watch these things.
Every one of these shows is a winner.
Oh, every single one.
But not every movie we talk about can be a winner.
That's true.
And you and I and Rich and Kevin and Ben. That's right. It was Ben. He's a winner, too. We're all winners.
We're all winners in this game of life.
Mm-hmm.
So please email us, viva@scarecrow.com. Please follow us on all of the social media things mm-hmm. listed below.
Mm-hmm.
Come into the store if you're in the area.
Absolutely.
Rent by mail if you're not.
Absolutely.
And
hail Satan.
Subscribe. Oh, yeah. My name is Lars von Trier.
We hope you have enjoyed the movie.
I hope you have a wonderful night.